Welcome, Dr. James Beckett, Sports Card Insights, here with Brad Bethune, the Texas card dude. We're going to enjoy hearing his origin story and much more, so stay tuned. But thanks, sponsors, Topps Panini, Upper Deck, Heritage Auctions, Huggins & Scott Auctions, Mike Stadium Sports Cards, Burbank Sports Cards, ComC.com, and Beckett Media, Beckett Grading, Beckett Authentication. So welcome. Should I say Brad or dude?
It's up to you.
Welcome to the show, and tell us about how you do hobby and how you got started and how you got to where you are right now.
Thank you. How I got started, we're going to have to go all the way back to the 1988 era, before, when Troy Aikman and Michael Irvin and Emmett Smith, when the triplets got in. I was with my father and my brother, and we were collecting, all three of us, baseball cards and sports cards, and went to a particular baseball card shop that's no longer in Plano. We bought, sold, and collected. We more bought than we did anything else. I think we kept that shop in business alone, my father with his purchasing. But I collected Mavericks, Ue Blob, if you can remember Ue Blob. And then I was part of the reunion rowdies, collected, of course, Aikman, Emmett, any Dallas Cowboys and any Texas Ranger, including Rusty Greer, Juan Gonzalez, and the greats of those eras.
Was that the same as your brother and your dad, or did you have your own particular collecting interest?
So my own. My dad, he was a Yankees fan growing up, and how a Texas guy became a Yankees fan, I still can't get a straight answer from him. But he liked Mantle. He was a big Mantle guy. He loved Mantle. And then because we idolized or watched Emmett and Aikman and the triplets, he collected a lot of the Cowboys. And my brother was a Griffey and Frank Thomas fan. He loved the long ball. He had Griffey on his wall, and he had Thomas on his wall, and he had Jordan on his wall. So he was more of a big name player collector than was a local guy. Time went on. I got interested in school softball, the partying in the college life, and got out, sold everything. Back in the 91, 92 era, I jumped back in because I thought it was cool. Met a young lady that changed my interest, and I got back out again. And more recently, when Pete Alonso hit the home run championship as a rookie, I'm like, wait a minute, who's this Pete Alonso guy? Because I'd always been a sports fan. I'd always watched baseball, basketball, football, hockey. Was a big Stars season ticket holder for a while. Always good. Go to one or two Cowboy games a year there for a while. Went to 82 Ranger games a year. So I've always been an in-person fan of games. Just when Pete Alonso became a home run champion, I'm like, wait, a rookie did this? Let me jump back into this. That's what jumped me straight back into collecting in 2019.
But so you had a pretty big gap then.
Yes, a very, very big gap.
Did you feel like you just picked up where you left off? Did you still have stuff? Or were you going back to your triplets and Cowboys and Mavs and Stars and Rangers? Or did you take a fresh look at it in the last few years?
So I kept like maybe 25 cards. Maybe through the years, and it was Emmett, Michael, Aikman. I had a George Bush card opening day where he's throwing out the first pitch. Will Clark, Ron Sandberg. I had a couple of cards that I just kept and drug around with me in a keepsake box. But when I jumped back in 2019, I just went completely fresh. And as many Pete Alonso cards as I could get my hands on. And then at the time, I went from Pete Alonso to Vlad Guerrero Jr., and from Vlad Jr., I started looking back at the Rangers and started looking at Nick Solak and started looking at just a couple of players up and coming, Sean Murphy, really players that were young and that I could collect and start prospecting with. So that's where I've really moved my focus into, is more prospecting and collecting very certain players for my collection. I'm very, very niche.
Yeah, are you still mainly a buyer, or are you buying and selling, trading, flipping, any of these other things? What's your posture?
Yeah, it's been interesting history. When I jumped back in October, whole hog, for a Texas phrase, for those of you who aren't in Texas, all the way, all in, hashtag all in, from October to December, I was just collecting. I was player collecting. I was collecting Rangers. I was collecting Stars, Mavericks, and then specifically Alonzo and player collectors. When I lost my job, December 18th, right before Christmas, I remember I was sulking in my hot tub with an adult beverage, and I had the very great privilege of my wife coming out to me, and she's saying, you know what, why don't you go full time into the hobby? And I go, really? Because I like a Scooby-Doo, I went, rrr? And she goes, yeah, make it full time. See if you can do this. You love the hobby. You love buying sports cards. You love sports. You always wanted to do some sports angle. Why don't you prey on it? And why don't you think about it and noodle on it and decide? I talked to a couple of people from church and a couple of people from the hobby that I considered knowledgeable. And about a week after Christmas, I decided to go all in and buy, sell, and collect trading cards and start Texas Card Dude sole proprietorship. So like John Newman, I pay taxes, have a P&L report, I pay sales tax. So it's fun.
First, a lot of listeners are trying to figure out, how can I get a wife like that?
I am blessed.
And if they're married, love the one you're with. But mm-hmm. still, it's nice to have a wife that understands you and can have a vision for you. So that's a great story. But so you can't just be a collector. You're in business. So what are your primary revenue sources? Are you messing around with unopened stuff? Are you buying and selling players and buying lots and eBay stuff? What are your venues? I've seen you at the shows, but where's the income and the outflow? Where's it happening for you?
That's a really good question for everybody who's listening, because that's probably one of the few things that how does he come up with? So I procure inventory through boxes. I do sell and open some wax. I will buy very specific wax that I like. So I still do stuff that I enjoy opening, because I buy two boxes. I buy a box to resell, and then I buy a box to open. A box that I open, if there's a Pete Alonso card, I keep a Pete Alonso card. If there's Nick Solak, I'll keep a Nick Solak. And then everything else I'll put on Facebook, eBay. I'll sell through Twitter. I'll sell in person. I did do some ComC, but I felt that I stretched myself a little too thin with so many different verticals. So I used to do 5 or 6 different verticals, and now I've pared that down to 3 to make sure that I focus. I've got a couple of card shops here in Dallas that I go to that I procure supplies and I procure inventory from or cards from. I just spent 4 hours at one on Friday. They kicked me out. I could have spent another 4 hours there. I do buy online from eBay. I do buy online from Sport Lot, specific players that I can acquire cards for that I think that I can flip or resell or however you want to term it. The one thing I don't do is I don't stand in line at the retail. I don't mess with that. If I go to Walmart or if I go to Target and there's cards there, yeah, I'll look. I've got a Walmart resale certificate. I've got a Target resale certificate. My time is more valuable than to sit there stand there for 4 to 5 hours and wait on cards when I can pre-order packs, or I can pre-order through eBay or through wherever and acquire them that way. So in that aspect, I'm different. I don't go to the retail, but I will pre-order what I can.
A lot of people are going to retail, and if time is money, then I'm not sure they're doing that well. A lot of people are there early and maybe being restricted or being shut out. But I want to focus on the selling, because there's different ways to buy cards and buy individual cards, groups of cards, all that. But when you're selling in the business aspect, because you're now approaching this as a business, and you open up a box, what's the point below which it's not economical for you to sell it? In other words, if you have a $10 card, there's different places to sell a $10 card. $5 card, yeah. But when you get to a dollar card, or a 50-cent card, what do you do? Because a bunch of the cards that you're going to get when you open up or you buy a group of cards, they're not all going to be high-demand cards.
Yeah, so
what are you doing with that?
That's a very interesting question. I tested it two ways for me. The first way was putting the bigger cards on eBay and then putting everything else on Sport Lots. You can go back. I don't think that's very advantageous or a very profitable idea. So what I did is I took another opening day box, completely opened it up, and then put everything on eBay. And the box paid for itself very quickly. I'm now, I don't know, 3X into that box.
Multiple listing things where you list on one listing, you can list a whole bunch of cards?
No, I did individual listings. I used eBay's Excel spreadsheet, then uploaded it that way. It was very time consuming. It took me a full day to build the spreadsheet.
But 75-cent cards, or what are you getting for them?
The lowest that I will do is 99 cents. If they sit, if they don't sit, they don't sit. And yeah, there'll be cards eventually that I'll pull off eBay, and there'll be cards that don't sell. What I'll do is I'll take those and I will put them in a particular box, and I will either donate them to Rich, or I will bulk them out into a 5,000 count box. Or at some point in time within the end of the year, I will do a show, whether it's a smaller one of Kyle's or something like that. I'll need inventory for that. So I'll pull out whatever names, stars or whatever, build a star box, and then donate the rest to Rich. So there's different ways to make a box profitable more than just trying to resell the box itself.
It's just that once you take out the big hit, I think I've told a story. I bought some opened boxes that still had the cards in the packs, but in every pack, the best card had been removed and quasi resealed. Now the boxes would seem to be a bargain, but not if you think that every pack hit had been taken out. We're buying basically, there were still some stars there, but it was a fraction of the price of what it would be if it was, I thought, wow, what a great deal. And then I looked closer. But those are the cards that are hard to sell. So you're saying if you put them on eBay one at a time, go to the trouble to do that, you'll sell a few when people are completing sets or looking for their player or what?
Yeah. So there's three types that I found that will purchase from me at that type. It's either A, through the mail autograph hounds who are looking for a particular person to send an autograph through the mail. It's B, somebody who is a player collector. Everybody at some point has a player or a team collector. Yeah. And then there's the set builder. And I've had each one of those types reach out to me and say, oh my gosh, thank you. I had a hard time for finding this card. Thank you.
But they just want one. It's not 10 Joey Gallo cards
or correct.
10 of the same opening day Joey Gallo cards. It's just the one card.
Correct. Correct. And I follow the Mike Summer method of this, where even if it's 50 cents worth of profit, it's profit. And all profit at the end of the day is profit. It gives me a chance, A, to collect Nick Solak cards or Pete Alonso cards. And it also gives me a chance to put some money into the household. So,
okay. You said all profit is profit, but is paper profit? Not so sure.
There you go. That one you got me.
Unless it's green paper. Unless it's money paper. But no, people think they've made a lot of profit when they haven't sold yet. And there's profit to be taken, but you have to take it to get the profit. So
right. Yeah, you do have to do
the same page there. But it takes time. And what I like about what you're doing is you're making somebody happy. You're
right.
Giving them what they want at a reasonable price. It's not, you can't sell cards for a penny. You'd make somebody really happy, but that's not. But if you're buying in bulk, if you buy a monster box of commons, yeah, you get a penny.
Yeah, I did. I can't remember them right off the top of my head, but I had five pillars: honor God, be honest, be a good price, have fun, be quick, and be very responsive. If I hold true to those pillars, then at the end of the day, all blessings come through. I'll be taken care of.
Great note to end on, Brad. I think your five pillars sounded like six to me. But
well, yes, that's true.
Count it when it's good stuff. So thanks, Brad Bethune, Texas Card Dude. We'll be back again tomorrow with another episode.
Thank you, sir.